Hey there, everybody. This episode of Walking the Floor is made possible with support from Fender Play. Have you or someone you know been looking to learn how to play the guitar? My friends over at Fender recently introduced Fender Play, the complete learning platform from the most trusted name in guitar, offering on-demand guitar lessons through a video-based platform that's designed to help you play your favorite songs and learn key skills in minutes. For your free trial of Fender Play, please visit Fender.com/walkingthefloor.
Hey, this is Justin Moore, and you're listening to Walking the Floor.
Shit, we made that rhyme. You're the perfect guest.
I'm telling you.
I'm walking the floor over you.
Walking the floor.
I'm walking the floor. Walking the floor over you.
Hola, senores and senoritas. This is Chris Shiplett, and you are listening to another fine episode of Walking the Floor, coming to you from a gray, overcast day in Los Angeles. It's salty out. I'm particularly salty because I spent the last, 4 days at Third Point Malibu getting as many waves as I possibly could in that crazy scrum, because as you might be aware, I got to go back out on the road next week, so I got to put all those waves in the Stoke Bank. Take it with me out in the Midwest and Canada, where, as far as I know, there's no real waves. I mean, I guess you could surf the Great Lakes, but, you know, that ain't happening. Anyway, lots and lots of solo acoustic shows coming up. Some of them are sold out, but there are still tickets for Knuckleheads in Kansas City and my gig up in Edmonton on the 21st, I think, up in Edmonton. And then all those dates down in Texas with opening for Paul Cawthon next month. Make sure you get online and go get your tickets in advance. It's going to be a good time down there for sure. Besides all the good surf, it has been a weird week with the whole Kavanaugh thing. Just when you think that things can't get any wackier and kind of shittier in American politics, in the Trump era, we take another big leap over the cliff with Brett Kavanaugh. I was listening to a Trump speech. He was out campaigning somewhere, and he was making fun of Dr. Blasey Ford's testimony and making fun that she couldn't remember how she got to the party or how she left or where it was or what, how many beers drank, whatever. And it made me think, people were laughing, and it really made me kind of sick to my stomach to listen to it. Because here you have this woman who I'm sure knew full well she was going to get torn apart by Fox News and Breitbart and the Republican Party and half the country. And then you got Trump out there making fun of her testimony because she's a little hazy on a couple of the details about something that happened all the way back in the 80s. I mean, I don't know about you. I was around in the 80s. I can't remember anything I did in the 80s. So I just thought she came off pretty brave. It was just unsettling hearing a bunch of people laugh at the speech that Trump gave. Anyway, that's my political rant for the week. Make sure you leave all your angry commentary on my social media, and I'll see you there. Thank you. Okay. Again, a big thanks to Fender Play for helping to make this episode of Walking the Floor absolutely free. Fender Play is the complete learning platform from the most trusted name in guitar, available on desktop and mobile, so you can learn anytime, anywhere. It's the quickest and easiest way to learn how to play the guitar, bass, or ukulele, with bite-sized video lessons featuring hundreds of top songs and classic favorites. They've got every kind of genre you could possibly imagine, so get over there for your free trial of Fender Play. Please visit Fender.com/walkingthefloor. And don't forget our good friends over at Zounds.com, where every order over $599 and above is eligible for their exclusive 12-part payment plan with no application process, no interest charged ever, and you just pay your first monthly installment, your gear ships immediately. That's Zounds.com. Most orders arrive within 2 days. And of course, D'Addario. Support for Walking the Floor comes from D'Addario.
D'Addario, a fine maker of USA-made instrument strings and musical accessories, is committed to sustainability through the Playback Program, recycling over 1 million used instrument strings. For more information on the Playback Program and how to help in its mission of reaching 2.5 million strings in 2018, please visit playback.daddario.com. Okay, let's get to the interview. Okay, I caught up with Arkansas native Justin Moore recently when he was way out west on his way to Lancaster. He's out here hitting the festival circuit. We talked about his love of the great outdoors, the joys of family, really every corner of his career, from his like small town beginnings in Arkansas to figuring out his way through the music biz in Nashville to success and ultimately to moving back home. We also talked a lot about his rock and roll influences, because I think there's a lot of rock and roll. There's a lot of honky-tonk, there's a lot of country, obviously, but there's a lot of rock and roll in Justin Moore's music, and I gotta let you know, he's got a brand new single coming out at the end of this week, Friday, October 12th. It's called The Ones Who Didn't Make It Back Home. Make sure you check it out, and one of these days, I'm gonna take Justin up on his offer for me to come down and go fishing on his property. Anyway, this is Justin Moore on Walking the Floor.
Down, the whole town showed up, sang Amazing Grace, watched the slideshow of.
Well, you just wait a while before you decide
make that judgment. what brings you out to California right now? Are you in the middle of a tour?
We are. We're playing Lancaster tonight, which I don't even know how far that is from here.
It's not too far. It's just what is that, up off the 14 somewhere, I think.
Yeah, I don't think it's too awful far. But, yeah, you know, summertime with country, for the most part, you're out doing fairs and big festivals and and the amphitheater type stuff. So the all-day festivals have kind of taken over the summer for country music. I'm not sure how it is in the rock world.
Yeah, same thing. I mean, it's funny to see, like, festival culture on the rock side of things has grown so much in the last, like, I don't know, 20 years or something, where I don't feel like when I was a kid, I don't feel like that was so much a thing. You sort of had the legend of, like, Woodstock and Cal Jam and things like that, but, you know, that's not where we were going, because I don't think there was any of that shit. But now with Coachella and, you know, all that stuff, ACL or whatever, like, it's because it's always been like that in Europe, like, you know, with Foo Fighters, like, we tour Europe a ton, and summertime has always been European festival time.
Yeah, yeah, it's like you said, it's grown over the course of my career. There seems like there's 10 or 15 new ones each year.
Yeah.
And but it's fun. It's a whole different vibe, as you well know, than playing in an arena.
Yeah.
It's I enjoy it, and the other thing that fans don't really understand is we don't get to see other artists who we're really good friends with very often, unless you're touring with two or three of them.
Yeah.
But, you know, the festivals, where there's 6-8 artists, you get a chance to catch up with your buddies, so it's fun for
I always say that kind of keeps me current, you know?
Yeah.
Because I don't, like, you know, I'm just kind of at an age where, like, music just finds me. I'm not, like, you know, sort of keeping up with the latest, greatest thing. And, like, every time we put out an album and go out in a cycle, you know, there's always a bunch of new bands and a new trend and a new this, that, and the other. So I would say, like, the festival scene kind of keeps me somewhat hip.
Yeah, that's a good point. I don't think I've ever been hip. Ask my 8-year-old. She'll tell you otherwise.
If you ask my kids, I'm the least hip human being. I'm always like, your dad's in a rock band, man. Come on.
That's a rock star.
Yeah, like be like, cool. Eh. The funny thing is, I don't know what it's like with how many kids you got?
We have 4, actually.
Okay, I have 3 boys. My oldest is about to turn 15.
Oh.
And then I got a 12-year-old and 10-year-old. But my kids, my younger two, they're still, like, I kind of like just made them listen to my music, you know, for most of their first
what
part of
what you liked listening
right,
to.
You know, and my music was the only thing in the house, so that's what they sort of naturally gravitated to. But now, you know, there's a certain point, and I'm sure you've seen this with your kids, where the outside world becomes a bigger
cultural influence than you are.
Oh yeah,
you
friends know? And
right, exactly. They go to school and they get turned on to stuff. So now my kids really don't listen to like much of any guitar music.
Really?
You know? Yeah. So like, I think that's a big factor in my not being the coolest human being in the world in their eyes anymore. You know?
Yeah. No, we have three daughters that are 8, 6, and 4.
Yeah.
And a little boy that just turned 1 in June, and so. You know, fortunately, my oldest daughter, who really kind of keeps up with you know, what's going on out there a little more so than the younger ones, but she actually loves country music, but she loves to sing, so, and she's actually a really good singer, so I don't know if we'll go down that rabbit hole or not down the road, but
yeah, you'll get there at some point. Yeah.
But yeah, but they like coming out on the bus.
Oh, the kids love the bus.
But it's not, they never want to go to the show, you know?
Right, right.
I think we're just going to stay on here and watch the iPad or, you know, whatever. They're going to, you know, YouTube videos of other people doing what I'm doing currently, and they won't come out and watch me.
That's funny. I remember, like, I think it was probably the first time my kids ever came out for, like, a proper bus tour. Like, they weren't just flying in for one thing.
Right,
like,
right.
We were actually, you know, day after day. Driving down the road on the bus, and I remember we had a day off, and I thought this was so funny because it's so not what I would do.
Mm-hmm.
But on the day after, like, can we go get on the bus? I'm like, what? It's a day off. No, we're avoiding the bus like the plague, man. Yeah, are you
getting off this giant petri dish?
Okay.
For today.
So I was reading your bio, and there was something that jumped out at me that I thought we could kind of start with.
Yeah.
And it, in your bio, it refers to you as an avid outdoorsman, but it doesn't go into detail. And being a city slicker myself, or I've lived most of my life in suburbia,
right.
You know? And it's like I find the older I get, the more I have this sort of like a fantasy that someday I'm going to live out in the middle of fucking nowhere,
right?
And you know, and someday that will happen, but it hasn't happened yet. And I'm always like kind of envious of people that do spend a lot of time out in nature doing whatever, you know, whatever sort of activities you're into. So what is it that you're into, like camping, hunting, fishing, like what sort of stuff?
Yeah, all of the above, you know. I think that's,
and will you take me with you,
because
I
on,
never
man.
Seem to have time to do it.
Anytime, buddy.
Yeah.
Open invite. No, I think kind of what you're into, for the most part, is a byproduct of how you grew up and you were raised and the people that influenced you growing up, obviously. And so I grew up in a town of like 300 people.
And no shit.
Yeah.
Where was that?
South of Little Rock in Arkansas, about 50 minutes south of Little Rock. And so not a whole lot going on, obviously. No, I mean, the town I'm from in particular, there's no red lights. There's 2 churches. You pick one of them. a little post office that has 1 employee, and then like a gas station, and that's it. And so, you know, I grew up in the age where we had 3 channels, you know, on TV.
Yep.
And there were, you know, say four music stations on the radio, and 3 of them were country, and 1 of them talked about the Arkansas Razorbacks all the time. So not only did that define the things that I did growing up, but it defined you know, the type of music that I listened to and ended up loving and now make. And but yeah, man, my grandfather was my hero, still is. He passed away a few years back now, but he was an avid hunter and fisherman, and so, you know, all my cousins and uncles and so
what kind of stuff are you hunting and fishing?
White-tailed deer, squirrels, rabbits if it snowed, which it snowed very little back home. And for me, I wanted to be just like him.
Yeah.
And so I fell in love with that stuff early. He had me at deer camp where you'd go and you'd pull up a trailer as if Poen, where I grew up, wasn't in the woods enough. You would go deeper into the forest and park your RV, and we'd stay there. Me and him would stay there all week and stuff. And it was just, you know, getting to hang out with him and spend time with him. And, you know, so I associate hunting with the quality time that I had the opportunity to spend with him. And then,
are you doing that with your kids now?
I am.
Or has the great, the evil iPad?
Well, you know, what we've done with the iPad thing is, as you know, they'll sit on it all day.
Yeah.
And literally not move.
I think that's the strangest part of modern technology to me is how quickly, and like we're all affected enough by it, but we didn't grow up with that shit. So, but like I see in my kids that it has really like quelled even like a desire to go root around the neighborhood and throw rocks and broken windows, or you know what I mean? They just don't even seem to have that. I have to like kick a prime out of my house, get the fuck out there and go see something.
Well, so that's what my wife and I have said. Okay, you can have X amount of time a day,
right?
And so we live on 50 acres and lease another 80. So we have like 130 acres. So we're trying to, like you're saying, shoving them out the door. Yeah.
Is that down around where you grew up?
Yeah. So I moved to Nashville when I was 18. So 2002.
Right.
And started working on, you know, pursuing this whole thing. And, and lived there for about 9 years. And 7-8 years ago, I had the opportunity, after we had kind of gotten rolling a little bit with our career, to go back home. And so it was never really my intention to move away, be away from home, just because I love where I was from and the culture. And I'm really close to my family, so I didn't like the idea of being away from them.
Yeah.
And so, but I knew that if I wanted to pursue this and have any opportunity to have success, that I had to go put my time in Nashville. And so I was the only one, like, of my buddies that I'm like, I'm staying home. I'm going to eat my mom's cooking until I'm 30, till they kick me out the door. And all my buddies are going, I'm getting the hell out of here, and that. I'm the only one that moved, and they all stayed, you know? So when I had the opportunity, it was always our intention, my wife and I, to move back there. And so we did. And actually, my other grandfather owned the property that I grew up on, where my mom and dad's home is, and his and aunt and uncle's, and had the chance to buy that from him a few years back. Mm. And so my wife and I and our kids, we live probably about 400 yards from my mom and dad's back porch, which at times with little kids is really helpful.
Oh, it's the best.
And at times it's a little too close, you know, when they just walk in. But no, it's been really good for our family, and you know this as well as I do, or better. You know, our kids and our wives and our families are affected either positively or negatively by what we chose to do with our career. And I never wanted, you know, me deciding to do this as a career before I had kids to affect my kids in a negative way.
Yeah.
And so it's been good for us in that sense, because people where I'm from, I don't know about you, but people where I'm from are really proud for me and of me and happy for me. But they don't really give a damn, honestly, that I'm doing whatever. They're like, all right, good, Justin, congrats, man.
Yeah.
Which is cool, you know, so they don't treat me or my family any differently since we've been back. And, you know, just an example of something that's pretty cool about being back there. 2 years ago, my daughter was in first grade, my oldest daughter, and had my first grade teacher I was growing up.
Yeah, so, how cool is that?
You know, it's just little things like that kind of. And I know that, you know, the folks back home, especially, you know, in school and stuff, the teachers and administrators they genuinely care for my kids and would do anything to protect them or you know.
So. Yeah, it's a really interesting thing. I think about that a lot. And, you know, there's such a huge upside for our families because of what we do in a lot of ways. But there's going to be a downside in there somewhere too. You know what I mean? Like with my kids, especially with me being gone to the extent that I'm gone. And we bring the kids out and we make it work. And I always think like a couple things, like, you know, this is the only life my kids have ever known. So it's not like I up and like started touring in the middle of their childhood. You know what I mean?
It wasn't a shock to their system.
Right. So they've sort of grown up in it. And then also like when I'm home, you know, I'm really home.
Right.
You know, like I'm not like home and off doing stuff most of the time. You know?
Yeah, and that's the way I explain it to people. They're like, man, you got to be gone all the time. And I don't know how it is in the rock world. I would think it was maybe a little different. We're typically only gone 2, 3, 4 days at a time.
Right, you know, we do that weekend thing?
Usually, yeah. And so if you really calculate the time, the hours that I'm home versus if I had a 9-to-5 job, I'm probably home more, to be honest with you.
Sure.
But, you know, I'm going for almost 2 weeks this time, and that sucks, you know. But at least I always say we have the chance to go out and do something we love to do, and that's a very you know, the minority of the world's population can say that. And
it's rarefied air, that's for sure.
And it's cool to, you know, when you grow up in a town like I did, I didn't even know this was possible, you know.
Yeah.
I remember my dad asking me when I was 17, 18 years old, and I became interested in music. He said, "What do you think about playing music for a living?" I said, "Hell, you can do that? I didn't even know you could do that."
Well,
let's talk
about that a little bit. Like, when did you sort of get hit by that bug?
Well, my uncle always was in a Southern rock band.
Okay.
And so I always loved music. I was always made to sing in church, even though I did it kicking and screaming. You know, I didn't really want to, but maybe subconsciously I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
But at least on the outside, it seemed as though I didn't, but my uncle's in a Southern rock band, so music was prevalent in our family, and musical ability, and my mom took piano lessons and different stuff growing up, but I was intrigued by him playing, and we would go to these little county festivals and fairs and watch him, and when I was 16 or 17, I just started kind of jumping up with him and his band and playing, you know, cocaine or
on guitar.
Not a guitar at this point. I would just jump up and sing. Moose Lodges and VFWs.
Sure.
And, you know, I'd Skinnerd and Marshall Tucker Band and Allman Brothers and that kind of stuff. So
that's funny. That's like those kind of venues are the same type of spots that the band I was in pre-Foo Fighters would.
Oh,
you know,
really?
That's like punk rock bands were always playing VFW halls, mm-hmm. Moose, Elks Lodges, all that kind of stuff. There'd always be some out of tune piano on the stage you'd have to push out of the way, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of them back home, and you know you can always play them. I don't think they probably made any money, but it was just kind of a hobby for him. And so I thought it was cool. You know, I loved the fan reaction and people. Oh man, you're a good singer. Blah blah blah. Whatever. Yeah. But it really didn't cross my mind that I could make it a career, or I didn't really know that I wanted to until my dad came up to me one day and said, "What do you think about playing music for a living?" I said, I didn't know you could do that, because.
Well, why do you think he asked you that? Did he hear something in what you were doing that?
Yeah, and I think probably more so. As parents, you can just sense things about your children that other people
passionate
can't.
About.
And I think he saw in me that I really enjoyed it and loved it, and you know he's done well for himself. And I mean, I'm middle class, you know.
Yeah, sure.
So, you know, growing up, we never had everything we wanted, but certainly had all that we needed.
Yeah.
And I
What's
watched him
in
bust
one of your
his
songs with a middle class,
which was middle class money.
Yeah,
or,
yeah, with a middle class tree growing money in the. Well, I forget. What,
yeah,
what,
yeah. If
whatever,
you wouldn't
so
ask
maybe
me,
it comes
would,
from
yeah,
that.
It's kind of the same. Yeah, that same thought. But I watched him, you know, work two jobs and you just work hard most Americans have to.
Yeah.
And I think he had higher hopes for me. And, you know, to be able to, it's less about money and more so do something that I absolutely love. And I think he could sense that I did.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And so, you know, we started kind of educating ourselves on maybe what that path would be, because we had no idea. I remember sitting down with the first time I ever met the only manager I've ever had and still have. And he's talking record deal this and record deal that. And I go, I hate to sound stupid, but I'm 18 years old, 17 at the time. I go, what is a record deal?
Right.
I mean, that's how.
Right.
You know, how little we knew.
You're lucky you had an honest manager
come into your life at that point.
Because that would usually be the point where they're like, I got this motherfucker.
Yeah, exactly. So, I was very fortunate in that sense, looking back on it. Just started kind of educating ourselves on that. And I enjoyed school. I was salutatorian in my class and you know, did well in school.
Yeah.
And so me not going to college was never a thought. Like, I just assumed I'm going to go to college. I'm going to get a degree in something. And,
yeah, sure.
And, you know, unlike most parents, my parents said, if you want to do this, go chase this. You can always go back to school. And it's typically the opposite of that.
Sure.
You know, and so I owe them a lot, obviously.
Yeah.
Understatement of the century. But, you know, for them to give me that opportunity, my dad got an extra job to help me pay bills for years in Nashville when I couldn't do it on my own. And
so that's when you moved up to Nashville, right about when you were 18?
Yeah, I graduated high school in May, and I think I moved in maybe October.
I mean, were you writing songs at that point?
Really terrible songs.
Right.
Yeah, awful songs.
Right.
and didn't have a clue how to write a song, to be honest with you.
Sure.
And so I went to 2 weeks of college, and I had a lit paper due. I'll never forget it. And I come home and tell my parents, like, I don't think I'm going back. And they're like, why, are you sick? And I go, no, not like today or tomorrow, like ever.
Right.
And instead of, you know, looking at me going, no, you're going to school, we've already paid for this semester, they said, all right, let's do it. And so they moved me up there, and I had my manager at that time, and he really great guy, really bright guy. He had never had success in managing. He coincidentally was an artist back in the day, had a couple of record deals, United Artists and RCA, I think. So he loved the business, but he never panned out as an artist, but he still was intrigued by the business. So long story short, he started trying to, you know, make some ends with some producers in town and different things. And so at that time, I'm still trying to write songs, but they're terrible. And, you know, we're trying to find songs to go cut just to have something to play for people.
Sure.
And because we still didn't even have that. But as you know, nobody knows you. You're not getting good songs from people. You're getting the garbage that, you know, all these other artists who are having success have turned down for good reason.
Yeah, yeah.
And at the time, it was frustrating. And I go, I don't know. Why won't they give me a good song? Looking back on it now, I totally understand it.
Right, sure.
Finally meet up with my current producer and longtime producer, and he grew up in Georgia, kind of the same way that I did, and he was speaking my language, and he played me some stuff, and I'm like, that's what I'm talking about.
Is that Jeremy Stover?
Jeremy Stover, yeah. Right. I'm like, that's exactly what I've been looking for. Like, that's it. And so he and I started writing songs together, and he really is probably my greatest influence in songwriting, especially at that point, because he taught me structurally how to put a song together and how to take your idea and actually make it good.
Did he come out of that like Music Row Nashville kind of songwriter?
Yeah, he was working for at the time Byron Gallimore, which is Tim McGraw's longtime producer.
Okay.
And he was kind of just starting out as a songwriter himself.
Right.
And trying to get into producing acts.
Yeah,
and,
yeah. That's the perfect time to meet that guy.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, so we really had a high level of success together for the first time.
Right.
You know, which was really cool, and I think it's made our bond much stronger. And
sure.
And
you still work with him now. Right?
I still work with him. And he's the only producer I've ever had. There's a trend here. I'm a pretty loyal guy. And you know, especially when it's working.
Yeah.
You know, but So I got a publishing deal. I think I was 19. I got a publishing deal. I made $12,000 a year to write songs. So I still had to have another job.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I got a chance to write with all these really accomplished songwriters. And I mean, I know they're sitting there going, oh, my God, this kid is just stop talking.
That's a long 3 hours when it's not working.
but you know, get to see it firsthand.
That, yeah. Who are the songwriters out there that you click? I know you wrote something on your new record with Jaron from
Yeah, Jaron's awesome.
Yeah. Love that guy.
He's great. Their band's awesome, too. But no, at the time I was writing with my publishing deal was with a guy named Keith Stegall, who's produced all kinds of successful albums, but most notably all the Alan Jackson stuff, and so you know, had the chance to work with him, you know, closely, and some of the other guys. Became friends with Red Akins, who's one of the most successful songwriters, especially the last 25 years in town. David Lee Murphy, who has had tons of success, and then more recently, I've gotten d- to become buddies with like some guys, Rodney Clawson, who's had a great run here of late, and Casey Beathard is another name.
I think I interviewed his son.
Tucker?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's Tucker's dad, right?
Yeah, it's Tucker's dad, and a really interesting family. Tucker's grandfather, Casey's dad, just went into the Professional Football Hall of Fame.
Oh, right. Yeah, he's got a real, like, sports lineage in that family.
Tucker's older brother plays for, I believe, the 49ers, quarterback for the San Francisco 49ers. Tucker obviously has a career in music going, and and so I told Casey last time I was with him, I'm like, man, I need to find out what you're feeding those kids, and incorporate that into my kids' lives. But no, a great family. But no, to sum that whole thing up, I was really lucky that at a time where I had no idea what the hell I was doing, I was able to be around a lot of guys who were really, really good at it. And I would like to think that I learned a little bit from each and every one of them, and it's made me at least a serviceable songwriter.
So you're woodshedding, writing, learning the craft of it, working with Jeremy, I'm assuming recording demos and stuff.
Yeah. Exactly.
How did you get a record? Were you performing as a solo artist all through that time?
You know, I was doing a little bit, but in Nashville, man, it used to be way back in the day, the Waylons and the Willies and that kind of stuff, where these record label executives would stroll into a bar and discover somebody. And as you know, that's just not the way it works now.
Right.
It's all about, you know, creating and developing and maintaining relationships and keeping people who, you know, have a big voice in the industry, but, you know, keeping them up to date on what you're doing and different songs. And fortunately, I had written a really good group of songs with, or at least we thought they were, with these guys that I'm talking about. Jeremy, my producer, he was starting to have a little bit of success as a producer, and getting a few more opportunities in that side of things. And he did some stuff for Scott Borchetta, who's the head of my record label. And
which label are you on?
It's a subsidiary of Big Machine Records, called the Valerie Music Company.
Yeah.
And so met Scott. He came out and watched me play with some version of my band 12 years ago or whatever it was now, 15 years ago, I guess. But and he liked what he saw and said, man, if you'll give me a little bit of time, I'll give you a deal. And at this time, I'd been turned down by, you know, three or four different labels. And every time you do it, you go, there's no more doors to open.
Strike out.
You know, you're 21 years old and you think it's the end of the world. And
well, you know, we all want, you know, it's tough. Like, I always try to tell myself to, like, relax. Because, you know, of course, you make a record, you want to put it out the next day, you record a song, you write a song, you're like, oh, I got to get, you know, we're not patient.
No, we're not, and nobody likes to hear the word no.
Sure,
it sucks. I mean, your kids don't like to hear it. Yeah. Your wife don't like to hear it.
Yeah.
We don't like to hear it. And I think it sucks even worse when it's something that you're super passionate about.
Right.
And
how do they not hear that? This is the shit,
and
man.
You're this close to it.
Yeah.
You know, it came from you. And, And so, you know, and also, when you're 21 years old, you don't know what the hell you're doing. You don't know who you are. You don't. You have no sense of really reality, to be honest with you.
And you think you do.
You think you do. And so, when I met Scott, I thought, man, this is. I like this guy.
Yeah.
You know, and I had the only record deal that I had been offered at that point was one where they said, "You don't have any songs. We'll give you a deal." But you don't have any songs, and your producer's got to change. And I stood up and I said, thank you very much for your time, and I walked out.
Right.
And I think we had five or six songs at that point. They all made the record, and I think two or three of them became number one hits. And,
right.
And so that's one of those where you go, yes.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
In your face.
Yeah. I mean, that's really interesting because, you know, I'm always curious how people early on in their careers, you know, wrest some control, artistic control.
Right.
And I think that's exactly how you do it.
Well, and I got really lucky because the vision that I had for me as an artist Scott Borchetta was totally on board with.
Right.
And, you know, typically that's not the case for most brand new artists.
Sure.
Usually, at least in our world, they kind of run you through a factory and tell you you probably should do this and you probably should do this. And
And then maybe if you have some hits and you sell some records, then you,
exactly.
You do
and
your
so
thing.
I don't really know why I got so fortunate.
Yeah.
But I'm certainly thankful.
Speaking about that, like I hear a lot of different, you know, musical stylistic influences in your music. So I was curious, like, what are your main country influences, but also what are your main non-country? You know, it seems like there's a lot of rock and roll in your music.
Yeah,
too.
You know, I loved the real traditional country music.
Yeah.
You know, I loved singers like I heard the interview or the sit down you did with Vince Gill, who to me is one of the greatest singers, regardless of genre, period.
Sure.
And loved his stuff. I loved, and he's an incredible musician too, but I really loved the George Strait stuff and Alan Jackson stuff. Yep. I like the fact that Alan Jackson wrote all his songs, you know, that influenced me in that setting. And obviously, the same laundry list as everybody else will say, Waylon and Willie and,
sure.
and Merle Haggard and all
classics.
Those guys. But probably my favorite artist of all time, which is kind of funny because there's not a lot of similarities in our music, is Dwight Yoakam.
Oh.
I absolutely love Dwight Yoakam.
He
was obsessed
put out
with
such
him.
A good tune recently.
Man, he's...
Have you heard that Pretty Horses song?
No, I
haven't. God, I got obsessed with it.
I got to check that
out. In the last couple of months. It's
oh,
so
wow.
good.
Yeah, I got to check that out.
Remains one of the best fucking singers ever.
Man, and he's just, to me, he was like Elvis. When he walks on stage, you're like, you know, taken back, and you can't take your eyes off of him.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but outside of country music, I was real big into the Southern rock stuff.
Right.
You know, Lynyrd Skynyrd, Marshall Tucker Band, Allman Brothers.
Have you seen that Lynyrd Skynyrd documentary?
The one that just came out?
Yeah.
Yes, it was awesome.
I just watched it a couple nights ago.
I've watched just about all things Skynyrd.
I thought that it was great. You know, so good to see, because I really didn't know. I know their music, but I didn't know their story much. So it was great to sort of hear all the behind the scenes stuff.
There were some rough characters, buddy.
Rough dudes, for sure. But I was a little surprised, and I really liked the documentary a lot, but I was a little surprised that they didn't much talk about the influence that Skynyrd has had over country music.
Yeah.
Because as much as Skynyrd has influenced rock and roll in a huge way, I think maybe they influenced country more. Because country music didn't sound like that.
No, I was going to say, if they came out today, they'd probably be on country radio.
Absolutely,
you know?
Yeah.
And they
it'd
were
be
country
like Blackberry
boys.
Smoke or something, you know what I mean? Like, yeah.
And they were country dudes, man. They were from, you know, Jacksonville, Florida, and just Southern. And but kind of the influence bands like that have had on my music, and probably where you can hear it is the guitars being more prominent,
right?
You know, and rock.
Who plays
and,
guitar on your last record?
I forget who played on the last one. Derek Wells has played on a lot of my stuff. Tom Bukovec has played on a lot of my stuff.
You have some great twang.
Thanks, man.
On there, man. I love, like, it's funny, man. I think that's what drew me to country music is the guitars. I mean, the songwriting, the singing, it's all great. But the guitar, for me, is like, that's the hook. When I hear that good twang over something, I'm just like,
And there's a guy out here that you probably know him, but I think one of the greatest ever, speaking of twang, is Pete Anderson.
Oh, hell yeah.
And Dwight.
Yeah.
You know, they made some awesome. We played way back up on the bridge, and you could hear it, you know.
Yeah.
But
I gotta interview that dude. So I've interviewed Dwight before, but I've never interviewed Pete. I gotta
just don't interview them together. I don't think that'd be a good idea. But no, and we just cut an album that's being mixed right now. I'm done with it, and we tracked it all. And Derek Wells played on it, and Brent Mason.
Oh,
so this upcoming album, I did some stuff a little different on my last album. My first three albums were really, really traditional. I consider really traditional country music mixed with the Southern rock, somewhere in between there. And on this last album, you know, I still wanted to stay true to who I was, which is a traditional artist at the core, but I also wanted to kind of get out of my comfort zone a little bit, which is hard for me to do.
Yeah.
you know, with country radio sounding different over the years, and you know, it was important for me to kind of stretch my legs a little bit in order to maintain relevance and still be on the radio. But
do you get a lot of radio support?
I do. I've been really lucky that you know, over the my entire career, really, outside of a handful of songs, I've been really well supported. And it's a that's a huge you know, deal for a country artist specifically. And so even though now there's so many more different outlets out there, country radio is still king, you know, as far as our listeners. And so we did some different things on the last album, or the album that's out now. I didn't write nearly as many of them, and so fast forward to this upcoming album that hopefully will get out next year, first quarter probably. I wanted to go back and write every song like I'd done in the past, and I wanted to do a really traditional sounding album. So Brent Mason's on it, which is
he's played
on. I mean, there's no telling how many albums he's played on throughout the 90s and 2000s. And
in the interest of full disclosure, I will tell you, I recently took a Skype guitar lesson from Brent.
Really?
And it was so awesome. It was incredible.
He's a good dude, and man, he's fun to watch him work. That's the first time he's played on any of my stuff.
Oh, cool.
But I've been a huge fan for a long time. Paul Franklin, who I know you've had on.
Yeah. He played on my new record that I just recorded.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah. He's so talented.
Another monster player.
And so he's on the new album.
Oh, cool.
And so I wanted to go back and get some of those guys who have played on all these millions of albums that have been sold. And it's got kind of a 90s, early 90s kind of vibe to it.
Yeah,
which I'm,
cool,
I'm kind of when I was coming of age and learning to really love country music.
Yeah.
So
it's impossible to make, unless you really like make it like kitschy, which I'm sure you didn't. But that's one of the great things about music is like in your head, it's drawn from this 90s stuff, but it undoubtedly sounds like right now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, and it's funny too, and you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. So I'm writing these songs and they sound to me exactly what you said, 90s, and I want this to be honky-tonk and twang and all this stuff. And it's amazing when you get into the studio and so-and-so plays something over here and you're like, hey, what was that? That's a cool tone.
Yeah.
And then, so my point is, you go in and you intend to do this, and you do something that is completely different.
Yeah, you always wind up taking a left turn somewhere.
Exactly. Yeah. So the album, my intention was to go in and make it sound like it was 1992, and it was Mark Chestnut or Garth Brooks or whatever. But it sounds more like my first album on speed, you know, which was real country stuff with the cranked up guitars and stuff. So, but
when's that going to come out? When's the new one coming?
I would say we're going to try to get it out in the early part of next year.
Okay,
it's being mixed right now. Guy from out this way, Chris Lordalgie. I don't know.
I don't know him personally, but
he's incredible. And so we'll put a single out to radio. I think we're trying to do that in October.
Okay,
and then you know, we try to always time our albums coming out from the singles peaking.
Well, that's great, man. Do you want to play a song?
Sure.
Because some people do, some people don't. It's totally
whatever you
up
want,
to you.
But I'm easy,
oh, I know.
Brother.
One before we do that, I'm doing this partnership thing with Fender, who has this new platform called Fender Play that's like online lessons.
Okay.
Were you a big lesson guy? I mean, we kind of talked about that a little
bit. No, I'm not a great guitar player. Right. I'll just be honest with you. It was never my...
maybe you could sign up for Fender Play.
Yeah, I know. Maybe I need to. No, I remember I took one or two lessons when I was about 8.
Okay.
When your hands aren't big enough, you know.
Right, right.
But,
man, I remember trying to get that G chord going when I was first playing guitar.
Yeah, sucked.
Nightmare.
But I was obsessed with sports growing up. I played baseball and basketball.
Okay.
And was way into it. And I remember my mom and dad telling me, you're going to have to pick guitar, baseball, and basketball. You're going to... And so I was like, we can get rid of the guitar. Little did I know, you know, had I been taking lessons since I was 8, hell, maybe I'd be playing on my own album.
Maybe you wouldn't need Brent Mason over there in the studio.
Exactly.
But, all right, cool. Well, let's hear a song. That would be
cool.
Great.
All right. I'm in the middle of 2 weeks on the on the road away from the house, and so kind of getting a little homesick. So I've been playing this song and sending it out to my wife and little ones. It's called Till My Last Day. It was a big record for us off of our, oh Lord, I think second album. So it's been a few years back. But anyway, it's called Till My Last Day.
People say I'm just a rough boy, ain't no good for you, girl. It's a dead end street trying to love me, yeah, I'll wreck your world. I can see why they're all talking, looking back at my past. I got a bad name, but a man can change. I'm living proof of that. Till my last day, till my last breath of everyone that can, I can love you the best. Till my last day, I'll be loving you all the way up till they lay me down, 6 feet under the cold hard ground. Till my last day, I'll be loving you. Baby, I might meet all my friends, shoot the bull, have a beer too, but you know I'll be the first one to leave in a hurry to get to you. Somewhere deep inside your angel eyes, I found a place to rest. But don't ever doubt that I'll be around. And baby, don't you ever forget. Till my last day, till my last breath of everyone that can, I can love you the best. Till my last day, I'll be loving you all the way up till they lay me down, 6 feet under the cold hard ground. Till my last day, I'll be loving you. Till my last day, till my last breath, everyone that can, I can love you the best. Till my last day, I'll be loving you all the way up till they lay me down, 6 feet under the cold hard ground. Till my last day, I'll be loving you.
Monster guitar playing on top.
All right, that was Justin Moore on Walking the Floor. I'm a poet and I didn't even know it. Make sure you get on over to walkingthefloor.com because I'm going to put a bunch of links up so you can check out where Justin's at, where he's playing shows, what's going on with him, and you can go buy his tickets, stream his music, and buy his t-shirts. Okay, thanks again to Fender Play for all their support. If any of you listeners are interested in learning how to play the guitar, the bass, the ukulele without the usual hurdles, check out a free trial by visiting fender.com/walkingthefloor. And that's going to do it for this week. If you're bored, go to Spotify and follow the Walk in the Floor playlist. It's all there. Hopefully I'll see you in Kansas City or Edmonton or Calgary or Milwaukee or, I don't know, Texas or somewhere. Who the hell knows? This is it. This is Chris Shiflett signing off for Walk in the Floor. Adios, amigos!
Sure left a hole down here. We just go on living and go on missing the wall.